good morning, everyone. Let's take our seats. It's wonderful to invite you here this morning. It's wonderful to see so many people out this morning to worship the Lord our God. This is going to be our mission. One of our four mission Sundays this year is going to be held this morning. Norman and Linda are going to give us a short report of the work of Project Romania. And Pastor's going to preach later on, and we're going to take our missionary offering during the singing of one of the songs, one of the hymns this morning. So let's just go on our hearts, let's just pray to the Lord this morning. Father God, we are so thankful that we are able to be here this morning. We are thankful, Lord, that we have the freedom to meet and to talk to each other and share the things of God with each other. Lord, we think of Christians across our world, Lord, where they are not able to meet freely like us, so we pray that your protection would be upon them. Lord, as we meet this morning and as we hear your word, we pray, Lord, that you would just speak to us, Lord, through your word, through your servant, our pastor. We just pray your blessing upon everything that is said and done would truly, Lord, be done for your glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
And it's wonderful this is Mission Sunday. That's wonderful, because you see, last week we celebrated the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. And before Jesus went back to heaven, he talked with his disciples. And whenever you read in Luke chapter 24, you read these words. Then opened he their understanding that they might understand the scriptures, and said unto them, Thus it is written, and thus it behoved Christ to suffer, and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And ye are witnesses of these things. And behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry ye in the city at Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. That was Jesus' mission. He was to suffer, bleed, and die for the sins of the world, and then he was to rise again the third day to buy our justification before God the Father, and then he endued us with his Holy Spirit and with power that we could reach all nations, not just one nation. He came to the Jewish nation first, they rejected him, and that rejection opened up the door for all nations. And so today, friends, as you sit here, you're Gentiles, thank God that he opened the door to all of us, and that we can have peace with God through Jesus our Lord and Savior. Sammy asked me to share something of what Project Romania has been doing since we've been home this last 2.5 years. Believe it or not, the work continues. We continue to send out finance. And since this war has started in Romania, we've sent out a lot of finance, and we're working in cooperation with different Christian charities and organizations in Romania. And we're buying some food, and this food then has been sent up to the Ukraine border. And it goes to places like this here, where the Ukrainian refugee centers. And some of these refugees then, whenever we send the vans up with the food, we bring the refugees back home. I shouldn't say back home, I should say back to Sarasvara. And this here is Project House. Project House was a house that Project Romania bought in 2001. And it's been empty this last 5 years. We've been trying to sell this last 5 years, couldn't sell it. I now know why. And God is all our God. And so now it's been turned into a refugee, a house for refugees coming down from the border in Ukraine. And this group of refugees only came to the house this week. They just moved in this week. And here they are, safe and sound. And that's one of the bedrooms. That's what we've been doing. I was talking to my friend in Romania last night, a fellow called David McGuire. He's been here, David, a number of years ago. But David was up and brought those refugees down this week. And this week we've had various requests. One of the requests comes from a place called Sunat, which is way up on the northeast border between Romania and Moldova and Ukraine. And up in Surat, there's a Christian organization working there. And every day, they have a large tent, and every day they make 1,400 meals for the refugees there. And they're crying out looking for help. And thankfully, this week we are loading a container, hopefully. I forget what area that is. And we're sending out this container at the end of the week, probably, hopefully, in God's will. And then, all being well, Linda and I are hoping to go out a few days after that for about 2.5 to 3 weeks, depending on the doctors and stuff we have for myself. But this is all in God's will, and we're trusting God for all of that. So please pray for the refugees. The war's continuing. Many more being displaced, but we have the opportunities of ministering to them. And with Linda and I going, we are hoping to go up to the border in Ukraine. We've been asked to go in 5 hours into Ukraine as well to minister to some of the Christians there. So So hopefully we will be involved in doing that as well. But we just praise God for the opportunities that we have of ministry. Should it be locally, or should it be by extension? And you see, whenever you're here, you're doing mission here. You're a mission church. You're reaching people in your area. You're reaching out, and that's what mission's about, friends. Doesn't matter where you're moving around all over the world, or where you're static in one place, you're still reaching out, and you're performing the work of mission that Jesus empowered you to do. And as you reach out here, you're also reaching out through your prayers into the lives and hearts of other people who need to know that Jesus loves them and Jesus died for them. And Jesus says it was about preaching the repentance and the remission of sins. And basically that's what we seek to do. Yes, we feed the people physically, but friends, above all, we want to feed them spiritually as well. And let them know there's a God in heaven. And even though they've been through suffering, just as Jesus went through suffering, even though they've been through all of that, they still have to know there's a God in heaven who cares for them and who's really interested in them. So pray for us in these incoming weeks that we get the finance to get this container right. It's £5,000 for a container, approximately. And then we have to figure out finance to buy the food. We're hoping to get about £5,000 or £6,000 to buy food as well. And then for the travel up to Ukraine, we'd value prayer for that. And also for the ministry that would see souls saved while we are there. One last request I would like you to pray for is a girl called Anne Poots. Anne Poots is my daughter Emma's friend, and they do crafts and all stuff together. But she's critically ill in Royal Hospital. She's critically ill in the Royal Hospital with pancreatitis. And pancreatitis is not a very nice thing. In fact, I think the mortality rate is pretty high with pancreatitis, as far as I understand. So we'd value your prayer for Anne Poots this time as well. So thank you so much for your time.
We love Pastor Norman and Linda, don't we? And I'm going to ask Linda to come. And we're not quite at the stage where we're going to lay on hands and that sort of thing, although we believe in the laying on of hands, but we do want to pray for you. You've shared prayer requests with us. You are part of our church family here. We love you, and we are for you, and we just want to pray for you with those requests that you have left with us. So let's pray together. And if you can, it's very biblical to extend a hand out in blessing. And if you're comfortable with that, please feel free to do that as well. Lord, we thank you so much that you are for us, not against us. We thank you that you own the cattle on 1,000 hills, and for you nothing is too hard nor too difficult. That for you impossible is just a word, not a reality. And Lord, Pastor Norman has shared some requests for prayer, and we are a church who believe in the power of prayer because we believe in the one to whom we pray. And Lord, we come before you with these requests, requests for finances, requests for favour, requests for safety of travel and journey and mercies, requests for souls to be won in the strong name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, we bring all these things before you, and we pray and we stand in agreement together with them. And we pray that all of these things would be yes and amen in Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray for Pastor Norman and Linda's physical health as well. Lord, that you would, that they would get the all clear from the doctor to be able to go and to fly and to do that which you've laid on their hearts to do for you. Lord, we just pray for a move of the Holy Spirit through Pastor Norman's body in particular. That, Lord, you would be proved as you have been time and time again as Jehovah Rapha, the Lord that healeth thee. So, Lord, we come before you with these prayer requests, and we pray that your good, pleasing, and perfect will be done in and through them. But, Lord, we also pray for Anne Poots, a friend that they have asked for prayer for. Lord, as we prayed for a move of your spirit through Pastor Norman's body, we pray right now for a move of God through her spirit, through her body as well. Lord, that you would heal her of this awful disease. Lord, that she would fall more and more in love with you. and that, Lord, you would not only save her physical body, but Lord, you would save her soul, and that you would have your way in and through her. And Lord, as we pray for Anne in the Royal, we also pray for our own Pam, who is in the Royal just now.
Amen.
Lord, you know what she needs you to do for her.
Yeah.
And Lord, we just bring her before you too, believing that you can and pleading that you will.
Yes.
And that, Lord, both of these lives, Anne's and Pam's, would be testimonies to the power of God. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Can I say one last thing? If we are loading the truck this week, any able-bodied people will be glad to hear from you.
The answer to this question might surprise you. Hey guys, it's me again, Douglas, and today I want to talk to you guys about the Holy Spirit. Yeah, because I think this is a really important topic, and I also think it's one that a lot of us, including me, have been kind of confused about. And so my first question is, what is the Holy Spirit? Well, the answer to that question is, the Holy Spirit is God. And when I say that the Holy Spirit is God, I'm not saying that the Holy Spirit is like the power of God, or like an energy that comes from God. No, the Holy Spirit is God. So a better question than what is the Holy Spirit is, who is the Holy Spirit? Because the Holy Spirit is a person. So actually, instead of saying what is the Holy Spirit, it would probably be better to say who is the Holy Spirit. So let's try that again. There, that's better. The Holy Spirit is a who, not a what. And we talk a lot about God the Father, and we talk a lot about Jesus, but we don't talk a whole lot about the Holy Spirit. God is three persons in one. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is incredibly important. The Bible says that when you believe in Jesus, you will have eternal life. And when you believe in Jesus, the Holy Spirit comes and lives in your heart. God himself lives with you. They call that receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit. But again, the Holy Spirit is not a gift like a thing. It's the gift of having God himself come and live in your heart. And he does so much for us. The Bible says that the Holy Spirit helps us know how to pray. The Holy Spirit, he gives us power. He helps us to do the things that God has called us to do. It used to be that the Israelites, they had a temple. And that's where the power and like the presence of God was. Right? The temple was kind of like a house for God. But now, because of Jesus' sacrifice for us, we can have the Holy Spirit living inside us. We are God's temple. That is a big deal. Like, that's crazy. We get to have the Holy Spirit. We get to have God with us all the time. That's awesome. And the Bible says that the Holy Spirit, he acts like a seal, like a guarantee for our eternal salvation. So yeah, I used to be really confused about this because a lot of the things that the Bible says the Holy Spirit is, or the things that it says the Holy Spirit does, are like things, right? Like it says the Holy Spirit is a seal, or the Holy Spirit is a gift, or the Holy Spirit gives power. But the Bible also shows us a bunch of times that the Holy Spirit is not an it, but a he. He is a person. He is a person that you can make sad. There's a verse that says, don't grieve the Holy Spirit. Don't make the Holy Spirit sad. You can't make a something sad, only a someone. Jesus told his disciples to baptize in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And that's three people in one person, three parts of the same God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. So I really hope that you will believe in Jesus Christ. You will believe in Jesus to save you from your sins so that you can have the gift of the Holy Spirit. Because let me tell you, he's awesome. The Holy Spirit helps us and he encourages us and he shows us the right way to live. He, not it, is an incredibly wonderful, amazing gift. The Holy Spirit is God.
That was cool. I liked his red hair. Well, summer's here and it's great to see the sunshine. It's great to see you all in church today and for those listening online. Some announcements, or just, I love that, just what's happening this week in the church. As our children leave, we just pray that you will know blessing and that you will have a great time up there and you'll have fun most of all. Pastor Norman mentioned about loading the truck, and I was just thinking, if you let Pastor Sammy know, and we are actually stronger than we look, Pastor Norman. Okay, there's a strong bunch here, and I'm sure we could coordinate and get a chain gang going there to get that stuff in the truck. So let us know, and we'd be happy to help. So Wednesday night then at 8 o'clock is our midweek prayer and Bible study. If you're free, please come along and join us. Tomorrow morning in the main church sanctuary is the funeral service for Maureen Reaney, and many of you will remember her. She's not been well for quite a few years now. It's at 11 o'clock, and we remember just her life and give thanks for her life, and everyone is welcome to come to that. Also, if you're interested in baptism or church membership, please speak with Pastor over the next few weeks. We'll be looking at that. Now, last Saturday, the children have just gone, but we had our messy Easter event. We had about 40 children, local children here, and their parents, and a lot of crafts and goodies. We even had an Easter bunny, Stephen. Oh, I'll give it away. A really creative and interactive way to show God's love in our community, bringing to life the Easter message and bringing life from the Easter message. And that's what we're called to do, to love here. A really great morning. And just thank you for everybody that was involved in that in whatever way. It was really, really super. So just one date for your diary coming up. As I said, we're stronger than we look. On the 12th of May, we have our next Work and Witness Day. And that's a day where we get the whole place spring clean, summer clean, winter clean, whatever. So Rosemary and I will probably do our usual 9 o'clock early start because we're early birds. If we see the rest of you around 10 o'clock to 12 o'clock, that would be great. And we'll work through that time and do as little or as much as you can. And I think Pastor's buying the chips again. Woo! Haven't told him that yet. Right now, we're going to lift our missions offering. During our next part of our service, we're going to sing Jesus, Hope of Our Nations. Thank you, Pastor, for praying for our nations today. Let's worship together as we give.
Jesus, my Savior, Morning.
Morning.
The reading this morning is from John chapter 15, verse 6, 26 and 27, and chapter 16, verses 1 to 15. So bear with me. When the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who goes out from the Father, he will testify about me. And you must also testify, for you have been with me from the beginning. All this I have told you, so that you will not fall away. They will put you out of the synagogue. In fact, the time is coming when anyone who kills you will think they are offering a service to God. They will do such things because they have not known the Father or me. I have told you this so that when their time comes, you will remember that I warned you about them. I did not tell you this from the beginning because I was with you, but now I am going to him who sent me. None of you asks me, where are you going? Rather, you are filled with grief because I have said these things. But very truly I tell you, it is for your good that I am going away. Unless I go away, the Advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. When he comes, he will prove the world to be in the wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because people do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father, where you can see me no longer. And about judgment, because the prince of this world now stands condemned. I have much more to say to you, more that you can now bear. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all the truth. He will not speak on his own. He will speak only what he hears, and he will tell you what is yet to come. He will glorify me, because it is from me that he will receive that what he will make known to you. All that belongs to the Father is mine. That is why I said the Spirit will receive from me what he will make known to you. Amen.
Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Help me, hold me.
And Lord, as we come and we gather around your living word, that is our prayer. That the Spirit of the living God would fall afresh on us this morning. So Lord, we pray in these moments that you would have your way. We pray in these moments that you would be heard. Lord, I pray that you would hide your servant behind the cross, and only Jesus would be seen. And that, Lord, we would leave this place equipped, empowered, and with a deeper appreciation of who you are and all that you've done for us. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, good morning.
Morning.
Good morning. It's been a really good morning so far, hasn't it? It's been a really good morning. And I pray that you've been encouraged and you've been inspired, and that as we come and we gather around the word of truth this morning, that we will be built up together in the most holy faith. That we would be challenged to live for Jesus all the more. And that we would, as we've just prayed, we'd leave with a deeper appreciation and understanding of who God is and all that he has accomplished, and that we would be overwhelmed afresh by the love that he lavishes upon us. This morning we're going to be starting a new journey together. As Pastor Norman said a little bit earlier on, we live in the reality that the tomb is not only empty on Easter Sunday morning, but because of Jesus' victory over sin and death, we are a resurrection people. And we are a resurrection people who can rejoice in an empty tomb every Sunday and every Monday and every Tuesday. And I'll not go all the way through the Saturday, but you get the point. We are a resurrection people. Our reality as the people of God is that death is dead, that love has won, that Christ has conquered, and that we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. That's something to get excited about this morning. And I can see your faces are excited, but your voices can be excited too, right? So as we begin this journey from Easter Sunday and we find ourselves the Sunday after Easter, we embark on a new series together, looking at the one whom Jesus promised he would send from the Father in his absence. This is a series which is going to take us right up until Pentecost Sunday, which is in June, as we celebrate the birth of the church and the coming of the Holy Spirit upon those disciples who gathered in the upper chamber as commanded by the risen Lord. That's another song reference I've got in there this morning, right? But it's very exciting. So in anticipation of his arrival, we're going to be spending some time in the Word together, looking at who the Holy Spirit is, what the Holy Spirit is like, and why the Holy Spirit came. And we're also going to look at why all of this actually still matters to us as 21st century Christians gathered together in East Belfast or listening and watching online. For the scriptures are highly practical. They're useful for instruction, for conviction, for correction, and for training in righteousness. And as the people of God, we need to be finding them. We need to be studying them for ourselves, seeking the help of the Holy Spirit to enable us to understand the words that are written and how we are to apply them to our lives correctly. And this morning, as it's Missions Sunday, we're going to be taking the time to dive into the passage which Jeannie brilliantly read for us. It was a long one. And she didn't make any mistakes, but I made a mistake. You probably noticed that there was the word fried was in there instead of grief. Don't ask me how on earth that happened. Autocorrect is wonderful and terrible at the same time. It's my fat fingers. And as Peter tells me week after week, you need to proofread your slides. But there we go. But she read it for us brilliantly from John's Gospel, where Jesus has just left the upper room with his disciples after having their last meal together before Jesus would go to the cross and lay down his life. And throughout this conversation, he references the one who would come, one who would be sent from the Father to ensure that we were not left as orphans, but rather that in Jesus' physical absence, he would still be present with us and with them through his Spirit. The passage which Jeannie read for us reveals to us the work or the mission of the Holy Spirit. And today we're going to look at three different facets or three different aspects of that mission. We're going to look at how it is the Holy Spirit's mission to testify about Jesus. How it is the Holy Spirit's mission to prove the world to be wrong about sin, about righteousness and judgment. And then we're going to look at how it's the Holy Spirit's mission to guide us in all truth and to glorify Jesus. That sound like a plan?
Yep.
Sound like a journey you're willing to go on this morning? Great, because if not, you're kind of sat here anyway. So that's great. But the first one is that it's the Holy Spirit's mission to testify about Jesus. Jesus says, when the Advocate comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who goes out from the Father, he will testify about me. I want to ask you a question. You know I love to ask you questions. And some of those questions don't require answers, and some of them do require answers. This is one of those that does require an answer. But have you ever met somebody who is essentially just an extension of somebody else, or who puts you in mind of somebody else? Have you ever met somebody like that? Right? Somebody who either really reminds you of somebody, or you're like, they have spent far too much time with this person and they are turning into this person. It doesn't mean that they are that person, but it does mean that there are aspects perhaps of their personality or the way that they look or the way that they dress that are consistent with that other individual. More times than I care to admit recently, I have said something, or I have done something, or I have given a look, and Chloe has went, "All right, Stephen." For those who don't know, Stephen is my dad. He's went, "All right, Stephen." I didn't mean it in a bad way, but there were certain things that I did, or certain ways that I said something. My favorite one of my dad's, I call them my dadisms. My favorite one of my dadisms is whenever he's annoyed, he says, "Ah, stick it up your nose," right? You know, and he says it in love. But you know, these little things that I have picked up down through the years. Even the other week, whenever I was with Pastor Joanne and we were over a cup of coffee, I said something, I did something, and she went, "You just look like your dad there." Right? I look like my dad. I sound like my dad. I sometimes have mannerisms and personality traits that are like my dad, but with God as my witness, I am not my dad. And everybody said amen, right? Yeah. With God as my witness, I am not my dad. My name is Sammy, not Stephen. I am married to Chloe, not to Sharon. I'm dad to Amy, Sophia, and Bump, which was really weird to write down and say out loud, right? Not dad to William, to Samuel, and Andrew. I like good music, not bluegrass music. I live in Belfast, not in Georgia. I vote for it. No, we'll stop. We'll stop there. We'll leave it there. You get the picture, what I'm saying here. I am like my dad, but I am not my dad. And it's a loose illustration here. But it's important for us that whenever we are looking at the Holy Spirit, that we recognize that the Holy Spirit is not Jesus. The Holy Spirit is not Jesus in the same way that Jesus is not the Holy Spirit. But both Jesus and the Holy Spirit are God. And together with God the Father, they form the Trinity. God in three persons. We sang it at the start. God in three persons. Blessed Trinity. So bearing this in mind, everything that the Holy Spirit does is consistent. Consistent with the testimony of God's revealed character through the life of Jesus Christ. So the Holy Spirit, the advocate, the helper has come, and his mission is to testify about Jesus. In other words, to tell us and to show us who Jesus is. To remind us of all that he has taught, and to reveal to us a deeper understanding of who Jesus is. Sometimes I have people come to me, and they bear their heart to me, and it's one of the real privileges of this calling. But sometimes I have people come to me and they say, "Pastor Sammy, I really sense that God is saying this, or that God is asking me to do this, that God is telling me to walk in this way." And whenever this happens, the first question that I ask myself, imagine it's the internal monologue going here. I ask myself, is this consistent with what Jesus taught? Is this consistent with what's contained within the Word of God? Is this consistent with Jesus' character, which is revealed to us in the Scriptures? Because if it is consistent with the character of Jesus, and it doesn't contradict what is written in the Scriptures, in other words, it doesn't go against what's written in the Scriptures, the likelihood is that the Spirit of God might just be working and moving and prompting the life of this individual to action. And I think this is important to raise this morning, because a lot of us often find ourselves asking the question, is this God or is this me? Is this God or is this me? And whenever you find yourself asking that question, go to the Scriptures. Go to the Scriptures. We need confirmation from the Word of God. Go to somebody who is further on in their faith and journey than you are. Go to somebody who you trust and somebody that you respect. Ask for their opinion as well. You need to have these things confirmed in a number of different ways. See, the Spirit of God, the Spirit of truth, has come to testify about Jesus and to reveal to us his nature and his character, that we too may be like him and molded into his likeness. Jesus also goes on in verse 27 to say, "And you also must testify, for you have been with me from the beginning." The advocate, the helper, the Holy Spirit of God, he will also equip, empower, and enable us to testify about Jesus to a world that is in need of him. The mission of the Holy Spirit of God is to testify about Jesus and to empower us to be missionaries where God has planted us, that we might also testify of his goodness and of his grace. There's a beautiful, beautiful verse tucked away in one of the Psalms, and it says, "Surely I will see the goodness of God in the land of the living." We are to tell of the goodness of God in this generation, in this time. Some of us God has called to Romania, but the majority of us God has called right where we are, missionaries for him, wherever he has planted us. Another way that the Holy Spirit's mission is to prove the world to be wrong about sin, righteousness, and judgment. Don't worry, this is not going to be a separate 3-point sermon. We're going to fly through this bit. You remember going to church services, and I've been guilty of it as the preacher before, where they say there's 3 points, but each point has 3 sub-points, and those sub-points have 4 sub-points each, and that sort of stuff. This is not what this is going to be, but we are going to look at sin, we are going to look at righteousness, and we are going to look at judgment, but we're going to do it quickly. Okay? Jesus says, "But very truly I tell you, it is for your good that I am going away. Unless I go away, the advocate will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. When he comes, he will prove the world to be wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. About sin, because people do not believe in me. About righteousness, because I am going to the Father where you can see me no longer. And about judgment, because the prince of this world now stands condemned." I want you to imagine for a moment that you're one of the disciples who are hearing this for the very first time. I've said it a lot as we journey towards Easter. It's very easy for us to jump to the end of the story, because we know what the end of the story is. We know how this all plays out. We know what is going to happen because it's all written down for us. But the disciples did not have that benefit. Imagine you're one of the disciples for a moment being told by Jesus that it's better for you that he goes, that he leaves, that it's for your good that he is going away. It would have been nigh on impossible, I would say, for them to even consider the notion that there would be one who would even come close to taking his place. After all, they'd seen him with their own eyes. Open blind eyes. They had witnessed as he had fed thousands upon thousands of people with 5 loaves and 2 fish. They had watched as he called forth his mate Lazarus, who had been dead for 4 days, and called him forth from the tomb. They'd seen him worshipped as he'd rode into Jerusalem on the back of a young colt. So how on earth could it be for their benefit, for their good, that he would leave them? See, Jesus in these moments is saying that it's better that the presence and work of the Holy Spirit be with them than his physical, bodily presence. It meant that through his Spirit, whom he would send, he would not have the limitations of a physical body, but that he could be omnipresent. In other words, he could be everywhere. We believe, as the people of God, that Jesus is here right now by the power and the presence of his Holy Spirit, don't we? Otherwise, we gather in vain. Otherwise, there's no point to what we're doing. Because he promised that, and we believe it because he promised that whenever we gathered in his name, there he would be in the midst of us, and that to bless us. And who's feeling blessed this morning? Right? He promised he would be here, and he's here. And just as we believe it, our brothers and sisters in Carrick, Nazarene, believe it. And Skegoneal, Nazarene, believe it. In the Shankill, in Donegal Road, in Bangor, in Clyde, in Watford, in Perth. In the Free Presbyterian down the road. In Berlin, in Madrid, in Rio de Janeiro. By his Spirit, he is here. And by his Spirit, he is in all of those places as they gather in his name at the same time. That's amazing, huh? That's amazing. So it is better for us. It is for our good that he has sent the Spirit, for he is with us always. And if we have trusted in the name of the Lord, if we have trusted in Jesus' name for the salvation of our souls, we are also told that Christ lives within us. How? By the presence of his Holy Spirit. What a hope! What a joy! He has not left us as orphans, just as he said he would. He lives within us. Hallelujah. Get excited, folks. It's okay to get excited. And the mission of the Holy Spirit is not only to testify about Jesus, but to convict or to prove the world wrong about sin, righteousness, and judgment. But how does he do that? Firstly, about sin. About sin because people do not believe in me. Verse 9 tells us. The rejection of Jesus, unbelief in him, and all that he has accomplished is a sin which leads to death and a Christless eternity. There's no way I can sugarcoat that for you, folks. It's the reality. But the mission of the Holy Spirit is to tell the world of the importance of trusting in, relying on, and clinging to Jesus, that we might not only spend eternity with him when we die, but that we might be transformed into new creations in the here and now, living for him. Who's not the person that they were before they met Jesus? I know I'm not, and I pray that you are not, because the scripture tells us that if anyone trusts in the name of the Lord, that they are a new creation, that the old has gone, that the new has come. And that's another reason to get excited. Can you tell? I want you to get excited this morning. We have a lot to be excited and joy-filled about. And if you are a child of God this morning, and you have accepted him as Lord and Savior of your life, you are only a child of God because of the work of Jesus on the cross and the prevenient grace of God which sought you by his Holy Spirit's presence. If you are born again of the Spirit of God, it is not your job to convict the world of its sin. That's the Spirit's job. But it is your job. It is our job to tell the world of their need of him and of his deep, deep love for them. Those who have been forgiven much ought to forgive much. Glory to God. About righteousness. About righteousness, because I'm going to the Father where you can see me no longer. Whenever Jesus ascends to the Father, it was proven in this that he had perfectly fulfilled the purpose for which he had come to earth. The will of the Father had been done and that he had proven himself to be righteous. That is, free from guilt and free from sin. His ascension, which we will celebrate in a few weeks whenever we look at the promise of the Holy Spirit, his ascension also proved the lack of righteousness or the unrighteousness of the world that rejected him, of our world. For the world
For if the world had been free from guilt, if it had been free from sin, if it had been righteous as it was whenever it was created, if it had been righteous, Jesus would not have had to come. In other words, the Spirit will convict the world. He will prove to the world their need of a Saviour. And about judgment, Jesus says, and about judgment, because the prince of this world now stands condemned. Church, there is coming a day when all evil, all famine, all war, all of the injustices that we see with our own eyes, when all of these will cease. There is coming a day when all these things will cease. There is coming a day when the evil one, the enemy of our souls, Satan, will be crushed. Right now, as we look around the world, it would be so easy for us to get downcast. It would be so easy for us to become weak of heart and crushed in spirit. Even as we look around our own community here in East Belfast and witness as families are having to choose between heating their home and eating a meal, as families mourn the loss of family members and friends who find the weight of their troubles too much to handle and took things into their own hands and took their own lives. As we see an increase in poor mental health and an increase in injustice and abuse within the home, it may seem as though we're fighting a losing battle, and it may seem as though all hope is lost. But let me tell you today, brothers and sisters, lift up your heads, for a day is coming when there will be a final reckoning between God and Satan, the prince of the earth. And let me tell you, on the authority of this good book, on the authority of the word of God, which is truth and has never been wrong and will never be wrong, God has already won. God has already won. Satan is already a defeated foe, and he just doesn't know it yet. The mission of the Holy Spirit is to testify about Jesus, to prove the world to be wrong about sin and righteousness and judgment. And finally, from this passage, the mission of the Holy Spirit is to guide us in all truth and glorify Jesus. We read in verses 13 and 14 of chapter 16. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own. He will speak only what he hears, and will tell you what is yet to come. He will glorify me, because it is from me that he will receive what he will make known to you. The Holy Spirit will guide us in all truth. We've seen this in the work of the apostles, through the Acts of the Apostles, the book that we read together, and also through the letters of Paul and Peter and John, through the inspired word of God, which has been passed down from generation to generation, and we're going to pass it on to the next one, aren't we? Mm-hmm. Amen. The Holy Spirit is the Spirit of truth. Jesus reveals himself as the fulfillment of the law and prophets, the Old Testament, and as the way, the truth, and the life. And just as the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of truth, Jesus is the Word of truth. He is the truth, and he is the Word of God, the Father. And we're told that the Holy Spirit will guide us in all the truth. That's the literal translation, all the truth. You ever met somebody who talks about the YouTube or the Google, right? But this is all the truth, all the truth. He will guide us and open up the scriptures to us, revealing the character of Jesus, glorifying him by bearing witness to him. And this can happen in many different ways, and he may use many different gifts in order to do this. And we're going to look later on at some of the gifts of the Spirit. Not today, later on in the series. But the Holy Spirit's mission, his purpose, is always the same. The mission of the Holy Spirit, and by extension, the mission of us as the people of God, is to reveal Jesus to the world. Reveal Jesus to the world. So maybe today, as you sit and as you receive from him, maybe you feel a challenge from him. And you know I don't do this every time, but maybe you feel a challenge from him. Perhaps that challenge that you feel is to receive Jesus as Lord and accept his free gift of salvation. And I have good news with you, because remember earlier we talked about how these things need to be consistent with the character of Jesus, and they need to be consistent with the character of his word. Well, it's consistent with the character of Jesus because he told people to repent, for the kingdom of God is near. And it's consistent with the word of God because it tells us that today is the day of salvation. You've not got yourself to this place, and you're not imagining it up, if that's you this morning. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved today. But perhaps that challenge that you're feeling is to step out for God and to tell others of his goodness and of his grace. Again, I've got good news for you this morning. That prompting is also consistent with the character of Jesus and the word of God, for he tells us to go into all the world and to make disciples. And his word tells us that we are Christ's ambassadors, as though God were making his appeal to the world through us. Whatever challenge you're receiving this morning, and when the word of God is preached, challenge follows. Whatever challenge you're receiving this morning, if it is consistent with the word of God and the character of Jesus, it is of God, and we would do well to act upon it. And as we sing our closing song this morning, let us respond to the Spirit of God, who is moving, who is working, and who is challenging in this place. Open yourself to him this morning, that you may be a vessel through whom he accomplishes his mission to the world. Let's stand together as we close in song.
Lord, let your
Give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Do not quench the Spirit. Do not treat prophecies with contempt, but test them all. Hold on to what is good and reject every kind of evil. And may God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do it. Amen.